is Susan Bradley for CSO Online. We often set up technology to be accessible both internally and externally to our firms. Especially now with the pandemic, we want to make sure that people can access technology when they want it and where they want it. But often there's security vulnerabilities that get disclosed that point out that it may not be so wise to expose everything to the internet. I've personally known businesses and educational institutions that in the past would set up their entire infrastructure with all computers and devices with public IP addresses. Often attackers use a blend of attacks, including phishing lures to entice a user to enter a network, and then the attackers can go after the entire network as a result. Recently, two Microsoft security patches released in October showcased how attackers can use attacks to go after an entire network, just how you set up the network infrastructure itself. The first security patch we're going to talk about is the bad neighbor ping of death. The underlying issue is caused by the improper handling of router advertisement messages, which are part of the network discovery protocol. This attack can be triggered without authentication by a remote attacker. However, it's not trivial to use it in these attacks. Now, the good news is this bug can only be exploited when the source address is a link local IPv6. That means it has to be internal to the network. Most of us these days do not assign public IP addresses to our devices. We now put them behind firewalls and other devices to help protect them. On the SANS ISC website, they recommend that you do not disable IPv6 entirely unless you want to break Windows. For example, for many years, people would often recommend to disable IPv6, and that's not something you want to do willy-nilly, especially when you have Exchange deployed. There's a very specific way you need to disable IPv6. First off, you have to know what specific interface you need to disable. So you need to type in at a command prompt route print, and that lists the interfaces. For example, in my example here, I'm going to disable a specific IPv6 item in interface number 7 because that's my IP address or my network card that has the Ethernet connected to it. The item you want to specifically disable is the RDDNS. So you want to put in a command netsh int IPv6 set, and this is where the interface comes in, and you want to identify the specific interface, and then you want to disable it. It gives a very quick and easy OK. Now obviously once you patch, you want to re-enable that setting, so you want to go back and undo that. And that's just as easily done by putting disable. Or I should say enable versus the disable command. The risk of this attack is not necessarily a direct remote attack from the perimeter, but rather a blended attack starting with a phishing lure. So they've got to get inside the network first, and then they'll go after you. The second security patch released in October that's just as serious to an enterprise, if not more so, is the one impacting SharePoint. CVE-2020-16952 impacts SharePoint 2013, 2016, and 2019. This vulnerability occurs when an attacker or user uploads a specially crafted SharePoint application package to an affected version of SharePoint. The software fails to check the source markup of the application package, and remote code execution can occur. If the user has a specific permission, add and customize pages permission, it's possible that even unauthenticated users can be triggering this remote code execution. So you'll want to check to see how you've set up your SharePoint, and specifically how you've set it up for guest users in your organization. Both of these vulnerabilities point out the risks of exposure based on how your network is set up. While the immediate remedy in both of these examples to ensure you apply the patches, it's also time to step back for a moment and review and assess how your configuration and your networks are, especially now with the pandemic. If you're like many of us, you've probably quickly open things up, change permissions, done different things to get it so that people can work from home. Now it's time to go back a little bit and say, hey, is everything set up as good as it can be to make sure we are not attacked? Anytime you set up a computer, a server, a cloud service, or any resource with the ability to be logged in from the internet, you need to evaluate the extra precautions and resources you might need in order to protect that access. Too often, we set up group policy rules to set up firewall rules to allow access and don't make them specific to a certain network or grouping. The NIST organization has several documents and white papers on this very topic, talking about network segmentation. It's been a foundational best practice for many years for both on-premise machines, and now as we're moving more and more to the cloud, you should have the same things in mind. Whether you're protecting physical machines or servers, virtual machines, or even cloud resources, review how you've set up your resources and who and what has access to them. Always set up devices that are on the same subnet to only those that are required or authorized to do so. When you set up DMZs, configure logging and monitoring to the appropriate levels. Make sure you record the header and the payload information going through that network border, as well as sending the information to a logging system. You should establish an inventory of technology assets that connect to your network, including obtaining a listing of devices and IP addresses. Ideally, it should include any and all systems on the network. At one time, we would only have traditional computer systems, printers, things like that. Nowadays, the listing of devices that have IP addresses connecting to your network can also include Internet of Things devices, printers, telephones, and with working from home being the new norm, it can even include home devices that have been inadvertently added to your network. So, not only look at the impact of patching on your own network, look to see how you can better protect your network and your perimeter. If you looked at the risk of the October updates and immediately patched because you had a risk, maybe it's time to resegment your network, redesign it, reconfigure it, see if there's better ways to protect that access. This is not the first, nor will it be the last time, that a remote code execution vulnerability will be found on SharePoint servers. Review how you have them deployed and see if you can better protect them. As always, take the time to take a look at the topics out on IGD Tech Talk for the news of the day. Until next time, this is Susan Bradley for CSO Online.